and deliver a sort of a project or a work assignment that will be monitored through the experts available at the national level as well as from the WHO. And if you are found to be competent and good in the use of the tool, then WHO would like to hand over the tool and initiate a regular use of the tool in your state. So this is a preliminary meeting prior to another round of meeting that the WHO intends to have with experts joining from the other countries, including WHO headquarters. It would be more of a deliberation with the state officers to know about their experiences with this tool after the February training and what are their understanding of how they would like to go forward. Are they eligible with the available data that they have and other modalities related to it? So I think that would, what is the background of that meeting? And I'll just check on with the availability of the director to join for the welcome address. One second, let me.
Sir, I joined, sir.
I request Director NCDC, who has now logged in, to give a welcome address on this occasion. A lot of state officers have already joined in, sir, and we look forward to your welcome address.
Thank you, Dr. Akash, and welcome to all the state nodal officers, officers of Division of Climate Change at NCDC, officers of the Vector-Borne Disease Control Program, and officers of WHO who have joined virtually, Dr. Rup Kumari and others. I think all the, how many states have joined, Dr. Akash?
I think more than 20. I had this
participants, sir.
Yes.
Okay, so it's a good initiative, and while welcoming you all, I think I must highlight the basic importance which this subject or this particular interaction between the vector-borne diseases, outbreaks, and climate change, and the relevance of this climate change with regard to the outbreaks, with regard to the transmission potential of vector-borne diseases is concerned. So I think this has been very rightly conceptualized, that a lot of climate change activities are happening across the world. And we have, if you are following the news also, you can see that in Canada, the temperatures have suddenly gone up very, very high, and there have been a substantial number of deaths also in those countries. Similarly, we have seen in Middle East also, and then we have seen in our own country also, that many areas which were not having that climatic conditions experienced diverse climatic conditions during past few years. And in the times to come, looking at the scenario across the world, there are going to be significant climatic changes, and those climatic changes will definitely have impact on vector-borne diseases per se as well. And we all know that in our country, vector-borne diseases like dengue, chikungunya, Zika, and now we are already having a Zika outbreak in the state of Kerala. So these all diseases are a major public health problem. We have been seeing a transmission at endemicity level, and we have also been seeing outbreaks happening in various states from time to time. And we have seen that in various years, the dengue has been a problem not only in various states, but also in Delhi per se, where we have seen that large outbreaks have been noticed. And these outbreaks are primarily related to the high vector density and high prevalence of the infected persons which are there in the society. So I think what has been conceptualized in this particular meeting is that a early warning signal for dengue and other arboviral outbreaks is discussed in detail, particularly in line with the WHO tool or WHO model, which has been conceptualized. And I think it is as a result of the WHO TDR-led research program, which was conceptualized and then also piloted in 3 or 4 countries, apart from Brazil, Mexico, Malaysia, and others, where they found that this particular model, which was tested, field tested for about 18 months, they could find that the results are consistent with the various aspects of the model, wherein the transmission and the dynamics have been figured in. So I think now this is the time that we should be looking at this model a little bit more carefully, and we will be also planning some kind of piloting of this model in our own country and in our own states, so that we can have a firm idea that whether this model also works in our conditions as well. So I think this is basically, if I understand it correctly, this is one of the main objective of this particular exercise, where WHO and NCDC are coming together with the help of 2 divisions of NCDC, where these activities are primarily focused, and there is a need for larger interaction, not only inside NCDC, but also with the other stakeholders, which are a major player in this. And in this, I must say that Vector-Borne Disease Control Program, NBBDCP, has taken a lot of initiatives. And I don't know whether somebody is participating from NBBDCP or not. Dr. Akash, you can further elaborate on that. But to my understanding, what is important is we generate surveillance data. We generate a surveillance data which can give us an early warning signal with regard to that. We all know that a vector density above a critical level is the one which is a driving force, particularly with the outbreak related potential. So vector density is an important indicator, and for that, to assess the vector density in a particular area, there is a defined methodology which our entomologist will be appraising all of us, and that strategy has to be followed in a very, very scientific manner, so that early warning signs are carefully monitored with the help of effective surveillance, and we can take appropriate measures of vector control or integrated vector control and try to see that the critical vector density is always under control, and we are not able to have any situation where the vector density suddenly rises. But having said that, I must say that the climatic conditions are the ones which are driving vector breeding. We all know that particular times of a year where we are having high vector density, and we are also seeing that freshwater collections are there and a lot of vector breeding sites are created, and these vector breeding sites are particularly relevant with regard to the endemic diseases also, and with regard to one more disease, which I must say is yellow fever. I think we all know that India has been till now free from yellow fever disease, but we have around 43 countries in the world where yellow fever is endemic, in South American countries, in African continent, and in these, from those countries, we are having regular travelers coming into our country. And if some unvaccinated person brings this particular virus inside the country, and we have vectors also inside that, susceptible population is already there. So interaction of all these will lead to some kind of transmission of this particular disease from which we have been saved till now. So I think what I must highlight is that we should be able to clearly understand, but first say this particular model by WHO, which has been field tested also in our circumstances, and whatever are the conclusion or observations should be shared, and then finally it should be conceptualized in a form of a working model, or if some changes are required, then we can have a expert group discussion and then come up with a strategy which will be relevant to our country. So I think this is as far as I could understand this, but I will wish all of you have a very active deliberation, particularly on various technical aspects and also with regard to the various entomological aspects of this. So I'll stop here, and again I welcome you all from my own behalf and on behalf of NCDC to this important interaction. Thank you very much for asking me to.
Thank you, sir, and thank you for your support to this event. We have taken and noted your inputs and we will try to make the best out of it. Thank you, sir. So, I request the participant to mute their mic, please. Yes. Okay. The director NCTC has in detail stated out what was expected of this event and the way forward that we have expected from what we'll be doing today. To summarize, I'll just introduce again for those who might have joined later on as what is the background. But prior to that, I'll first like to welcome again everyone who has joined by now, the state program officers of the climate change, the VBD officers, the IDSP officers, and the state entomologists, and also the division of the Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management at NCDC. For the state officers, I'd like to let them be informed that the VBD component under this program will largely be monitored by the Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management of working under NCDC. They are the subject experts and will be in a better position to guide you all on issues related to VBD. I also welcome the professionals from NIMR, Dr. Himmat Singh and Dr. R. Sridhiman, who has been the former advisor at NIMR and one of the important panelists that we have today in the discussion as a subject expert. And I will also, of course, welcome the WHO country office, Dr. Roop Kumari and her team. And I would also, I'm not very sure, but I think NVBTCP was expected to be joining, but if they haven't, I would request Dr. Ashan Sharma that if you could see that in follow-up, in the follow-up to this exercise, NVBTCP is participating because many of the NVBD officers from the states are participating in this, and it would be nice to have NVBTCP on board in this event. And of course, a small background has already been told to you in the morning. All that I need to reiterate out here is that this is a follow-up to the February meeting that we had. And today's major idea would be to have a detailed interaction with the states which are interested in implementation of this tool at their states. They should have the state level data available to exercise this and their willingness to exercise that. After the detailed meeting and with the states, it will be agreed upon as to which states will work ahead to take up these projects and the mentorship of these states in implementation of this tool. And of course, I missed to welcome IMD Dr. Sivan from the Indian Meteorological Department. And so now I request Dr. Simi Tiwari, the head of the Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management. Please mute your mics, please. Dr. Ashri, could you please? Okay, thank you. So I welcome Dr. Simi Tiwari, who is the head of the Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management, to make an address, please.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank Dr. Akash Srivastav, sir, to give me an opportunity to participate in this very important meeting, as I have taken over just a month back as a head of Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management. So that is no doubt that this is one of the very important initiative, one of the very important requirement once we are grappling with the COVID pandemic, and we really know that the need is there to generate the early warning signal so that we can take the timely public health measures and timely policy interventions could be taken. So no doubt this is one of the most important that we should rightly focus in our country. As we all know that IDSP is a well-established established program in our country, and meteorological department and ecological data is also available. But right now, once we are looking at, you know, generation and this field testing, sir, my submission to this house would be that those whosoever are the states interested in actively participating with us, so we should sit together and we should first look at the data points available, because once I have taken over the charge of CM, we met Dr. R.C. Dhiman at NIMR and Dr. Himmat Singh. A preliminary discussion has already been held, and we have been there to look what kind of geo mapping and what kind of satellite based data, remote sensing, they are really at a quite advanced. And we at the CME VM division, we also intend to complement our IDSP system for having a geo mapping data. So first we need to strengthen that, how, what are the data parameters which would be required for the early warning signals. So we are also we are also looking forward that Dr. Roopkumari madam, what presentation she is going to give on the initial introduction of early warning system tool available at the WHO hand. And so, sir, from my side, my submission to the interested state, that we can have a core group wherein we can sit together and look at the available data points, and just to look forward what exactly would be required for generation of the data points to feed into this tool. So we are also having a risk mapping training going on with the help of CDC is providing training to the staff of DZDP. So we are already into this, and we should also we are also going to look at the WHO tool available, and then at the data weaknesses. So that's how we can go ahead with this.
Dr. Simit Tiwari, are you still there? Hello?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, yes. Have you finished your address?
Yes, sir. The only concern is that once we are looking at this tool, we are really required to look at the data available with us. What exactly we could be requiring with respect to the meteorological data, ecological data, vector abundance data. And we to start with, we can just select two of the districts, or start with the Delhi state, or those who are, you know, interested states actively, they are those who are willing, their willingness to participate actively in this data modeling exercise.
Right, agreed. So thank you, Dr. Simme, for your guidance into this matter. And I once again would like all the states to keep a focus on the fact that she has very rightly mentioned it. The whole purpose here is that the tool will be of no use unless it's not put into use by the states to make use in their management of the vector-borne diseases. So please understand that endless numbers of training do not make any sense unless and until they are translated to the field level requirements by the state officials themselves. So that's the whole objective. In the end today, this meeting, which will already have the names of the states which find themselves eligible and willing to take forward implementation of this tool as a project with the mentorship of the national level officers and institutions, and of course WHO, and then deliver on to the required results, which can be further used as a model for the other states to follow. So that would be the major ending point of this session today. I now request Dr. Dhiman and Dr. Himmat Singh from NIMR to make an address, and I have other issues to attend to. So I'll request Dr. S.N. Sharma and Dr. Shiva Prasad to take on the moderation from here forth. and please ensure that we have an agreement on states taking forward this tool for implementation. So I invite Dr. Ashish Dhiman first and then Dr. Himmat Singh. Please, Dr. Dhiman.
Thank you, Dr. Akash ji. Good morning to everybody. I appreciate the efforts of the National Program on Climate Change and Human Health and WHO Country Office in pushing forward this theme of early warning system, at least for dengue in the beginning. It is heartening to see that all the state nodal officers are present here, and we will be requiring their presence for availability of data and for intervention data and for the parasite or viral load in the community. Just for the sake of all the nodal officers, to simplify the issue, I wish to say that climate change has three impacts: increase in temperature and sometimes decrease, erratic rainfall, and sea level rise. This erratic rainfall is going to create problem. Sometimes when we don't want rainfall, there will be floods, and when we need rainfall, there will be drought. So this indecisiveness or uncertainty of rainfall is likely to cause outbreaks. It is very right that you have chosen the topic of dengue for early warning. So therefore, thresholds of temperature and rainfall are essential to have the knowledge. For malaria, these thresholds are very well known. We have identified the thresholds of rainfall also for some cities in respect of malaria, that this much rainfall can cause outbreak. But for dengue, these thresholds of rains are not known. In malaria, rainfall can create the breeding habitats, it can flush off the breeding habitats, and it can help in survival of the vectors. But the vector of dengue is a bit different. It does not require rainwater collections for breeding. So here the role of rainfall in dengue vector is just survival. Rarely you will find, other than containers, the breeding of Aedes mosquitoes. We have done some exercise, so I will share my experience. In malaria, we identified some thresholds for around 21 districts, and we tried to validate that. We identified that yes, if there was that adequate amount of rainfall, there was outbreak, but in some districts, there was no outbreak in spite of suitable rainfall. So the same thing is going to happen in case of dengue also. So in such case, we have to know what is the load of that virus or parasite in the community. If the community is free from, say, malaria or dengue virus in the community, let the rainfall be there, nothing will happen. In some cases, outbreaks can occur without adequate rainfall. It happens when the intervention measures are not effective. Surveillance is not going on. We do not know what is the situation on ground. So these two, three scenarios are there. So for malaria or dengue, we will be requiring weekly data. Usually national program provides monthly data, but for working on early warning systems and particularly for dengue, we will need weekly data of dengue incidence, then what intervention measures are being taken, and what is the load in the community of that particular virus. So these things are very important. There was one issue. We can detect the early warning signals by seeing the density also. There are in literature, you will find BI, if it is more than 10, if it is more than 50, then the signals of outbreak can be there. But detecting the early warning system based on climate, if we know the rainfall is likely to come, so it will let us know before the breeding itself. So rainfall will provide very good tool for early warning of dengue outbreaks, and it can be very helpful. But why we are worried about the early warning systems? We are a developing country. Our health system is not fully equipped. So if we know in the beginning, we can gear up the system. We can bring in the health workers. We can bring in the entomologists who can go for surveillance of vector density or for viremia in the community. Because asymptomatic problem is there in dengue also. It is same in malaria also. So we have to go for surveillance for dengue, surveillance for vectors, then monitoring of rainfall. All these three parameters will be required. So unless the cooperation from the state government is there, this exercise cannot be undertaken. So it is very nice to see all the state officers, and we wish wherever we select or any this national program on climate change and human health selects identified some localities, I think there should be some representations, some from Himalayan region, from like Delhi or southern India, because we have seen in southern India the incubation period in mosquito is very quickly. It quickly, within 5-6 days, EIP is complete. In Himachal Pradesh, it will take 25 to 30 days. In Uttarakhand and Delhi region, in 10 days, EIP will be there. So we should take 3 different geographic areas, and it can be validated, the tool which has been provided by WHO. So with this, I just request all the nodal officers to please cooperate in this venture. This is the beginning of validation in dengue, and the same thing can be replicated to malaria also. And if we have these systems, we can avert outbreaks. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dhiman, for your remarks. I'll request Dr. Himmat Singh from the NIMR to make his comments actually, so that we can proceed further.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, Dr. Dhiman, has elaborated everything in a small gist. Though they have invested a lot in taking out the threshold values, which value will be at which place is very important. So what I feel is that increasing the cities in our country, they require early warning system like e-wards. They definitely need it, because we were also thinking of when the Zika outbreak came up here in Jaipur, that in Aedes aegypti we could contain them because they are inside the houses and on the peri-domestic area where they usually breed. But when it came to Kerala kind of place where outbreak has come, and the vector primary vector might be elbow pictus or something, where we are unable to contain them, where will we go in the tree holes to contain them? So similarly, this climate change will be more effective in the case of dengue when it comes to elbow pictus, where the impact of their breeding sites are basically dependent on the rainfalls and the temperature governing outside. Here in the mega cities like Delhi, we have to consider two things in the Aedes population. One is the indoor habitat, and the other is a peri-domestic habitat. And we need to club it in the e-wars system so that it gives a appropriate result. And because two systems are governing them. One is peri-domestic. After rains, they comes out, and during the very, very hot season, they go inside the houses and live with harmony to a human being. Dr. Dhiman rightly said that incubation period is very important part. Incubation period will change with the climate only in the insect system, because it can reduce and can increase in the system as the temperature rises. So the temperature, the basic is the temperature change. So we are always supportive, and we will be inputting all the details which you require. Dr. Dhiman is always having all the details. He has got a lot, 30 years, 40 years experience in that. So this is what we will be always with our technical expertise in the vector part. So thanking you.
Thank you, Dr. Himmat Singh, and we look forward actually for the support from NIMR as a center for excellence. So now, yeah. Actually, I would like to put certain technical remarks as per the agenda laid down. Good morning to all of you, Director Sir, Dr. Akash, Dr. Simi, Dr. Roo Kumari, Dr. Dhiman, Dr. Himmat Singh, Dr. Bhan, colleagues from the National Center for Disease Control, from the Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management, participating in this meeting. You see, the main credit goes to Dr. Roop Kumari from the WHO country office, actually, to put her efforts in the climate sensitive diseases, because Center for Medical Entomology and Vector Management has been assigned actually additional responsibility to help with regard to one component of the National Program for Climate Change and Human Health, that is vector-borne diseases. Vector-borne diseases actually are very complex and are influenced by the climate changing which are taking place not only at the macro level but at the micro level as well. So we need to first of all understand the complexity of vector-borne diseases in terms of the vector behavior, in terms of the pathogen behavior in relation to the climatic variable, and not only that but socio-economic conditions which are prevailing there, receptivity of the area, vulnerability of the area. But on 8th February, the with the help of Dr. Roop Kumari, WHO country office, Dr. Laith Hussain and Dr. Axel Kroger, who are expert at the international level, because this early warning response and this system has been developed by these people and have been tested or rolled out in three countries. So there were demonstration as well as actually presentation by both the experts. And Dr. Roop Kumari coordinated this activity. And before that, all the participants, whether they were having actually background as a nodal officer from the climate change or VBD SSOs, entomologists, zonal entomologists, even from the municipal corporations, health officers, entomologists, they participated during the meeting on it. Operational and user guidelines for the use of the early warning and response system, what are the tools, and risk mapping were also circulated by Dr. Roop Kumari to all the participants, and which are available with them. There were demo exercises actually on the data sheet, which were discussed at length, in fact, during that period also. And now Dr. Roop Kumari will highlight some of the points in her presentation. So there were introduction actually how to go about for the dashboard 1 and dashboard 2 in terms of the retrospective analysis of the model calibration. It was shown very beautifully there. Data structure actually included some components, in fact. That was population, weekly hospitalized cases, weekly humidity mean, weekly temperature mean, rainfall mean, they were actually taken up as alarm indicators. What Dr. Hima Singh and Dr. Dhiman mentioned, because there are no entomological actually component in that. So as a variable or as an alarm indicator, definitely we can look into it and discuss with the experts, Dr. Axel and Dr. Hussain. And you see, there were certain more actually sensitive indicators, means as a positive predictive value, PPV. They mentioned that actually this is the outcome of the automatization process of the data inputs out of these indicators which I have mentioned earlier. And you see, the dashboard 2 has been designed based on the prospective analysis and response action plans. So because you are having the recent data and what is actually the warning there as per the data available and what action we can plan. This is beautifully laid down in that model. And now we need to actually put into practice that how many states, districts are actually having very regular and authentic data with regard to dengue so that we can roll out. Now coming to a other challenge, I'll say that access to the meteorological data. So Dr. Bhan is with us. We'll take his guidance, and he's always helping hand to us. Actually, whatever way we require his help. And most important is that prediction of the alarm indicators and prediction of the outbreaks and transmission window periods and response system. They are also integral part of this EWARS actually system. So we'll understand when Dr. Kumari presents, sir. Now, in terms of the today's meeting, what actually we expect from the participant and how we'll move out, as my director and Dr. Akash and Dr. Simi I've discussed with them, and actually we want that how to validate actually the data which is with them, along with this putting this data into their system or this tool. And now whether we have weekly hospitalized data with them with regard to dengue. Because what we collect data here is confirmed cases, suspected cases, and probably we need to have weekly hospitalized cases also for dengue. So that data would be required. Then of course we are to synchronize the data of the IDSP and NVDCP as has been mentioned earlier. So now again after this, you know, we'll discuss how we can have mentors like Dr. Roop Kumari, Dr. Axel, Dr. Leth, for future actually to give us guidance actually, and to the state people also. Then we need to analyze. Now you see, we need to move forward along with this line, and this is actually a very important meeting and a way forward how we can move forward and take the guidance from the international experts and put into practice in the Indian conditions. So we'll discuss actually when there is a lot of technical discussions takes place. This is actually, I close here. Thank you very much. And I request Dr. Roop Kumari, Technical Officer VBD from WHO Country Office, kindly make her presentation on EWARS tools and its application in the country, Indian context. Dr. Roop Kumari, over to you. Please make it full screen, madam. There seems to be some technical issue, Dr. Kumari.
Okay. Hello. Can you hear me?
Dr. Yeah, Sharma? we can hear you, madam, but presentation actually full screen, kindly make it. You have shared the screen, but it should be full screen here.
Ma'am, you can unshare and reshare it. It is hanged somewhere.
This is your presentation? Yeah, this is me. So can you see?
It is coming, madam. Yeah, full screen. Yeah. Kindly make it. Good.
Thank you much. Thank you, Dr. Sharma and Dr. Akash, to take this initiative to organize a follow-up meetings for implementation of EWARS. And I would like to thanks to Director and CDC for taking this initiative for implementation of EWARS in the country. And Dr. Sharma has already described about the technical and all the summary of the EWARS. And last time in February, we have organized a meeting followed by training with all the state participants for
implementation of EVOL systems in the country, but because of the COVID, we cannot organize the follow-up meetings. So this is a very good initiative taken by NCDC to organize this follow-up meeting. And I will just give some outlines of the vector-borne disease and why we have to do prevention of the outbreak. And as all of you know about this, world is changing, and because of the population growth, urbanization, development activities, and climate change, and it leads to increase and emergence and re-emergence of infectious disease, including vector-borne disease like dengue, malaria, chikungunya. And major vector-borne disease accounts in the world about 17%. 7 lakhs deaths are caused by vector-borne disease annually. And during this time, Zika is also emerging as a new threat. And during 2007, in the history, if you see some publication, there are many examples are there of how this vector-borne disease transmits from one place to another place, like the dengue. When I was there at NBBDCP, where the dengue was limited to few states, and chikungunya was limited in 2006, there was an outbreak, and chikungunya was only the southern part of the country. Now we can see the distribution of chikungunya and dengue all over the states. And in 2007, there was an outbreak of chikungunya virus in Italy was recorded. And when we investigated, we found, and it was the source for the infection was from India. And about the ties, like now today we will speak about the Aedes-borne disease. Aedes-borne disease like the dengue, chikungunya, as well as the Zika. And now the Zika outbreak is now presently that's reported from Kerala. And these ties plays important role in North America. There was an outbreak when the unused tire was transported in some areas, and the air sticks into this tire. And after the monsoon, it leads to breeding, and if some parasites or the infective agents are there, then transmit the disease as an outbreak because the population on that area is susceptible. Climate change, already Dr. Dhiman has mentioned that the role of climate change is very important. Malaria, he has already studied a lot about how this climate factor, temperature, rainfall are related to predict some epidemic signal, outbreak signals of for the disease. And no doubt the global migration, like the we feel close to each other about all the country because of the connectivity. If there is more connectivity, there is more chance of transmission of the disease. And Aedes-borne disease prediction is Aedes disease. You can see this map how this distribution of the Aedes-borne disease in the global level. And Zika is now challenging because the same vector, Aedes aegypti, is the main vector of the Zika also, and chikungunya as well as the dengue. So I think that this EVOL system will be very useful in the country for prediction of this outbreak disease. Now, dengue is the outbreak prone disease. Every year we are getting the dengue outbreaks in the country. And chikungunya is definitely, chikungunya is also is endemic in our country, but there are many challenges. Breeds, like the breeding habitats, so if we can detect the breeding habitat, but we can control, but there's very it's very difficult, like the sometimes with the breeds of the overhead tanks, so that it's very difficult to approach these overhead tanks on the fortnightly or the weekly basis. And even the construction area is a major problem in the country, in our country, of all the development activities and even the rural area. The Aedes aegypti was limited, or dengue was mostly prevalent in urban area, in cities, but now spreading towards rural area, in semi-urban area. Why? What is the reason for that? Because the habitats of the vectors has been changed. The more development activities there in the rural area, they are also developed the system tanks and the coolers they are using, and leads to the breeding of these vectors. And this is the study, Sutta, I have done at NCDC Delhi when I was there at NCDC. And we always, Sutta, our teams, this is the work of my team, and we have a very good teams at CMA division, and daily that they go for this surveillance. And we collect the data, and what we have found the dengue season is very and autumn. I have divided the four season, all these cases as well as the HIV/CA. And what we found that during the summer, after the summer month of the rainy season, the breeding increase and it will take about 1 month to build up the density in those area as well as the virus activities in the mosquitoes. And so that mostly the cases are coming during the autumn seasons. And this publication is already there. And also what we have got this information, what we have tried to correlate rainfall data as well as the temperature data. And definitely we found there is some correlation like this. If the rainfall is more in the month of May and June, after 1.5 or 2 months, there is more vector density and definitely followed by case. So about 2 months, that's the gap of the more cases are there. But there was no system. There was no system on the time of the day in a systematic way. How can we detect the alarm, whatever that Dr. Sarma has already mentioned, how to predict this epidemic in advance. Indeed, I have also tried to correlate this rainfall data for Japanese encephalitis cases. And what we have found, month-wise cases, we have seen there was a shift of epidemic peak. Like the epidemic peak was started from the October in the Gorakhpur area, but after 2005, they are shifted in advance 1 month. Now it is started from the September onwards. And what is the reason for the shifting of epidemic peak in advance? And it is correlated with the climatic data. It is correlated, we found that it is correlated with the rainfall data and the climatic factors of that area. Early warning response system that has been developed by WHO-TDR, Dr. Axel, in collaboration with the Sweden University, Dr. Lair Hussain, and they were here 2 times, so that they came to India. And last, in February also, they have organized a training program for NCDC officer. So just a brief, this is the, what is EWAS tools? EWAS tools is a co-design approach. Co-design involves, it means that it making full use of each other's knowledge, resources, contribution to all the partners, all the stakeholders. If you want to implement this EWAS system, then again, we need partner. Like if the WHO has developed, WHO has also developed in collaboration with the other research organization. And then if we want to implement in the country, then directorate of NMBDCP or the directorate and CDC as the IDSP system. And I have discussed today morning, I have discussed about this issue with Dr. Late and Dr. Axel about how we can integrate in the future about the EWAR system with the IHIP. Then they said definitely it can be done. We can, in the latent stage, we can, whatever the data generated in the IHIP platform, like the weekly data, that can be used for the EWAS and that can be also linked. And we need district health manager who will feed this data and also local meteorological data. We have to correlate, we have to having a good collaboration with this meteorological department so that we can get in weekly data or monthly data. And also as the headquarter, what is the role of headquarter and what is the role of at the peripheral level. And Dr. Simbi was HOD CME has mentioned about this outline of what I want. Already this presentation has been done earlier by Dr. Leith. Just I will present some outlines, but we have to discuss here what is the implementation plan and how to prepare our action plan. We cannot select all the states in the country for implementation. We will select few states, and the states again, they can select few districts and where the surveillance system is good. So we will discuss how to prepare an action plan. And this is a brief history of the EWAR system. This is the continued process, and many literatures has been surveyed and activities have been done, retrospective data, and the innovation evolves where piloted in some country like Brazil, Mexico, Malaysia. So on the basis of continued process and the evidences that this evolves has been developed. So as all of you are working on the, for the disease situation and the outbreak, you know about the what is an outbreak. So I don't want to explain in detail the sudden unexpected increase of cases. Like in the case of Ebola and cholera, polio, where non-endemic area, even the one case of them may also be an outbreak. So in the endemic area, if there are about 100 to 120 cases every year, but all of a sudden the cases increase. Like in the last 2 years back, there was an outbreak of malaria in UP. The sudden increase of the malaria cases as compared to previous period of the previous year. So there was an outbreak of malaria in Uttar Pradesh. So if we will predict, outbreak in advance, definitely that we can implement appropriate interventions. And this data, whatever we have to enter the retrospective data, and on the basis of retrospective data, endemic channels will be built up. And endemic channel visualize the historical pattern and the seasonal peaks of the case number. And there is Z factors also. So for this, you just understand how to system the state and what are the requirements. And if some demo is presentation is required, then we will organize whatever we will constitute a core group, and we will organize a separate demo class for them so that they can understand. And if the cases first this case and late detected. And when mostly the what happened from the through the media, we could know, yes, the outbreak is there in some state. Now the online systems are very effective, real-time reporting is there, but in the past, we will see after the one decade, we only through the, we could know when I was there in the program, we could know from the media, yes, the cases are increasing in Maharashtra or that area. So it's a delay response. So delay response, delay detected, naturally we cannot implement the preventive control activities, then there's not opportunity for the control, definitely the cases will be more and deaths will be more. If we will detect early and rapid response early, then definitely we can prevent this outbreak. And this is again one example of the case study of the where I have conducted at ICDC and director ICDC on the time 2010 during the Commonwealth Games period. On the basis of our data, project data of CME, we could well to detect some outbreak signals for outbreak in 2010 during the Commonwealth Games period. In the month of July, we have detected something like HICIBI increase, and also we detected the virus in vector mosquito, and minimum infection rate was very high on that time. So we there was an alert that was issued by the director NVBDCP to ministry, MCD, and a surveillance team was constituted, and in all this area of the surveillance that was strengthened, and fortunately we were able to see this peak in 2003 and 2006. There was a sharp peak increase at the month of like October, but in 2010 the peak started increasing in the month of July, but through surveillance and through implementation of appropriate intervention, we could able to break this peak. The peak could, this epidemic or the peak could not reach that the peak high level in the month of October. So we could able to control that outbreak in Commonwealth Games area. Although the way we have not strengthened our surveillance activity and intervention like the central Delhi, where the outbreak was there in 2010. So this is a very good example, but there was no system on that time with the population. Now we have a system, WHO supported now system, EWAS tools is there. So Dr. Sarma has mentioned about the alarm indicators, and for this, there are two parts. We for this EWAS system, we have to enter all the retrospective data, whatever the 3 years, 5 years, and I will give you format how to enter the retrospective data. And all these epidemiological data, entomology, if you have the entomological data like HIBICI, even the use of RuboVita, if you have data, then you can also correlate. and meteorological variables like climatic, like temperature and rainfall, humidity, and these factors are very relevant with vector-borne disease. But with all this data that we have to fit in a format, and potential alarm indicators may be presence of density, climate, temperature, epidemiological, like seropositivity, blood sample. And there is an alarm threshold, and the line, that is the threshold through which we just calibrate and predict, which the alarm indicators converts into alarm signals. Like usually around 0.12, where it gives the highest sensitivity and PPV. So I will explain you what is PPV alarms threshold. There is an alarm threshold, which this is the line threshold that will be developed with the whatever the data that we have entered. And when I was there in Sri Lanka, I just used some dummy data of the country, India, about the HICI, also correlate all other epidemiological data. And this time we got this endemic channel. This is the blue one, is the endemic channel. And this is the threshold. And after that, there is alarm indicators are there. And PPE, what is the PPE? The proportion of alarm that successfully predict defined outbreaks. Okay, PPV is positive predictive value, and we will explain it in details during the demo class or demo presentation. Positive predictive value, this is the main PPV value where through which we can see about the sensitivity of this tool. Number of correct alarms period, total number, sometimes the false alarm also there. And if the sensitivity is 90%, it means it indicate is PPV. So 90%, 9 out of 10 outbreaks have been correctly detected. Like the 70, if more high, like 91, 93 is more sensitivity, it's good. And this is a few example of different country, Brazil, Mexico, Malaysia, where they have calculated about each variables. They have calculated like mean temperature, the sensitivity is 81%. And the rainfall 87%. Like the other cases, so the 100%. They got more PPV for the cases, but cases are more relevant. So you can play with all data. Whatever the data you have, you can just enter and you can play. You can see which value is more sensitive, and you can select. After that, you can select, this is the more factors which are more sensitive. Then we will see, okay, these are the cases, confirmed cases, or the OVTRAPS density, or these are not correlated with HINCI, not much. So we cannot ignore whatever the factors, whatever the indicators, which is the best, give the sensitivity, we can consider those. And Dr. Sanma has mentioned about the dashboard. There are two dashboard one and dashboard two, and that we have to discuss whether this dashboard should be maintained by a headquarter or should be maintained by state headquarter, and all these other dashboard two that will be maintained by the peripheral level or the PSC or the DST, where the data will be entered. So that will be discussed, and we will conclude. And dashboard, if the NCDC headquarter wants to maintain this dashboard one, they can maintain it. And password and username already has been provided. And retrospective data is important for the prediction of this evolves. I mean, based on retrospective data, whatever the data you have 3 to 5 years, this is the formats, like we have to give year, like we start about 2000, like 10 we will start, and district, if there are 15 district, you name in like the Jharkhand, there is 16 or 23 district, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you give name, and you will take one district, then the district population, then write down first week, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seven. Like if you start from 2010 data, then first, second, third, and 11 to continuously, it will go down. So, and they have taken about the hospitalized cases, and we will take the confirmed case by NVDCP. And whatever other parameters, we can take temperature, we can take rainfall data, and even with some entomological parameters are there, but we can feed all this data together. Retrospective data. Suppose you have feed the data of 4 years, then they divide into the will give the this is the, like the 2 years data. This is running data and other is to evaluate. We have to evaluate those data. And through this running data, some endemic channels will be built up and threshold will be there. And then after that, there is a to evaluate this data, then we have to calculate the sensitivity, like the current outbreak, the last total outbreaks, and PPV value that to be collected. Means that whatever the historical data, we have to divide in two parts. One is the running and one is the evaluation part of the where we have to calculate PPV and to test the sensitivity of the data. This is just an example, like this is the endemic channel. You see the ash color, the peak is there, and another peak, like blue one is the alarms, and when it will give the 1, 2, 3 alarms, so that we have to compare it, and we'll see whether it is false or it's really, it's crossed as threshold, then it will be prediction, and we will explain you in later stage. Risk mapping is also important. Last time Dr. Leith has presented about risk mapping is very important. If you know this is the risk area and we can implement a plan, we can plan for activity, we can implement the intervention, and we also combine the spatial and temporal prediction for effective public health response. And that can be done through this system. There is no problem. So usually what happens is if we are there are area endemic with some disease, we know like the Delhi, we know in some area there's cases, in some area there are less number of cases, and if MCD will like only they will implement intervention only those area where the endemic of that disease, it doesn't make sense. So we have to consider the other area also, sometimes the outbreak of the may be there, so we have to consider. This is very important tool like the mapping of the risk mapping and the prediction of the outbreak. This is the spatial distribution and the risk map. Definitely in the state further you can highlight what which district in the further in the district, which PSC, which sub center is more effective in transmission. You can plan your activity and the intervention plan will be cost effective way. So what is the EWAS experience in India? And we organize training of the way that Dr. Lath was there in 2019, and 15 participants from 11 states we have been trained. And then in February 8, the Department of Climatic Change and the Health Department, like the chairmanship of Dr. Kasivastho and also the leadership of Dr. Sharma. Then again, this meeting was conducted on 8th February, and they've invited all the state participants, and was very good training. And after that, because of the COVID pandemic, we could not organize the follow-up activities. And now this is the good opportunity. At least the NCDC has organized the follow-up meeting with these states. And this is the guidelines that I will provide you. And already we have also sent an email to all participants in the last meeting. And this is the link and password India_2020, but you can change. And just whenever you will open it and you go to the admin and you can change your password and username there. And every state can change, can develop their own password and username there. And we have to decide whether the dashboard will be implemented by NCDC or by the state headquarter and the peripheral level. So admin user will be there, like the headquarter or the state headquarter will be there. And the district manager, like they can use their own district data, they can enter, and also this dashboard one can be also displayed here. Even at the headquarter level, they can see what is going on in the dashboard one, dashboard two. So whenever you make changes, then you can just push the refresher button and it will save this data. And every time the one click will save this data. This will be explained not through this presentation. This can be explained in a separate demo class. If you will constitute a core group, definitely I will facilitate for organizing a demo class. And what we need to make a plan, and this EWAS system, we have to implement the EWAS, they should have a good surveillance system. And they have to strengthen the surveillance system, because if the data will be there, then only you can prevent outbreak. If there is no data, they cannot generate data even in monthly and the weekly data in some state and some district, then there is useless for implementing. So wherever, like in Karnataka, some districts has very good data, and Kerala is also a very good surveillance system. They have a weekly data. And this area, and I will request Dr. Sarma and Dr. Akash Srivastava, select those two states and the districts where the surveillance system is good and they are willing to strengthen surveillance. Then only when they have the data, they can enter. The first step of the EWAS tool, they have to fit the data. And just you timeline, fix some timeline and tell them to enter all this prospective data within a month, 2 months, 3 months. And after that, the second step, after then, that we will organize a demo training for them. And that can be pilot studies that can be done in few districts, in few states. And it depends upon NCDC and meteorological data. Definitely, they should have a good communication with local meteorological station. Even now, the meteorological data is given online or the Google's source. They have to identify what will be the source of climate data about the rainfall and temperature, humidity, and tapestry building. Hands-on training will be required. Time to time, definitely WHO will provide support, because this time we can organize virtual training. Anytime we can invite our colleagues from WHO TTR and Dr. Lad, they can join. Risk mapping, surveillance officer at IDSP already working there, and we can also use this tool for risk mapping of dengue, chikungunya, Zika, malaria. And I have already mentioned, definitely it can be linked with the IHLP and IDSP. If they are interested, because they are generating weekly data that can be used for the EWAS, and also in the later stage that can be also used. Even for malaria, it will be also very important, because we have to achieve malaria elimination, and EWAS system will be very used in low endemic area for the prediction of the outbreak. And this is the screenshots for the last training we have conducted in February at EWAS. Is a universal language in the form of the R software, which makes its integration possible in almost every HIS system. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Roop Kumari, for the wonderful presentation. You have not covered only EWAS, but you have given an overview of the Indian situation also with regard to dengue. Since you have a lot of experience working in the program as well as in the NCDC, even in NIMR also. So you have that sort of capabilities actually. And we are grateful to you that you came forward to help actually in terms of the climate sensitive disease. Already we are working on malaria, but dengue is also a very challenging sort of disease. And this response for all the state program officers who are attending this meeting, able viral disease. So we need to establish a system. So firstly, we are going to establish T-cell disease. This is a very important actually tool.
WHO country office. Considerably over the last few years, the change has been really speeded up. To apply the system to different areas, first and foremost, I'd say that Dr. Simmi Tiwari in the beginning said we need to map the hotspots and attempt to validate this model in selected districts in the states where the disease normally happens and where outbreaks or maybe the spurs that tend to take place year after year. Regarding meteorological data for those areas, we can, if the list is provided for the districts, we can look into for which areas the meteorological data are available. They should be. And we second thing is the tool has been, you know, elaborated by Dr. Rupa Kumari, and maybe through further trainings, the states can be further sensitized and trained and enabled to do those changes. We should use probably the recent data of not more than 5-10 years back, because if you go historically, the climate had changed, the response of vectors and the interventions might have changed considerably. So the response will not be same if we go, say, 1990s and now. So we restrict ourselves to limited number of years in the history if we go. And also the system, I feel, this is for Dr. Srivastava, please, Akash. The system, manpower is stretched for their work in almost all government offices, and I hope the same situation may be there. Though we have now nodal officers for climate change and human health, many states now have appointed probably some of the doctors also, which was there in the plan. So can we have some kind of an automated system? Disease surveillance being done through different systems that is fed into the system. It goes to EWAS, it goes to IDS portal, it's same data goes to IBB, DCP. So that the manpower is not, asked to do multiple kind of works for the same data. And the same can be done for the meteorological data also. So the disease data, meteorological data, and other variables, say population and disease load, they need to be automatically routed to the system so that a picture comes out. And then we really need to, after we test, first we have to do some historical studies based on limited number of years. And if it gives promises, we can design, collectively design a product to advise the district level health officer or district magistrates. Said your district is likely to have this. And we can make the forecast also, because now we have the forecast data available for next 3 to 4 weeks now at least. So if we can put the forecast data also in the system, we can generate an outlook also for the areas which are going to be impacted or likely to have. It may not eventually be realized because interventions do matter. But likelihood of the areas to be impacted can be identified, and where interventions can be speeded up, surveillance can be jacked up, and all those kind of things. So at this stage, I would say that we would like to collaborate with the project and provide meteorological data historically in the beginning, and once the system is identified to be workable in the certain number of districts, for those districts the real-time data and the forecast data can also be routed to the system so that we come out with and it's very topical. The disease burden is going to increase. Dr. Rupa showed the historical facts also. And considering the climate change, rising of temperature, the vectors will be multiplying probably faster. Dr. Dhiman said in South India, the cycle is completed in about a week's time, maybe less than that. And the Himalayas, it takes about 20-25 days. So that would be changing. Climate is a dynamic parameter, and probably the pests and hosts, they also are dynamic entities. They may be adjusting to the climate. So we use recent data. we collaborate with the project. I assure to provide the data. At this stage, we can do that. And whenever the trainings are there, we would like to really participate in the system. So that we have a system of disease early warning system to begin with dengue and maybe other vector-borne diseases also. And at this stage, though it's not really related, as Dhiman mentioned, that they have come out with a model of 21 districts in the country for malaria. So if those thresholds, Dr. Dhiman, can be shared with NCDC and IMD, probably we can start advising to the health managers of the district, not to the public directly. So there is likelihood of these favorable thresholds to be achieved in near future, or they have been achieved at least, so that some health system preparedness can be checked. So these are the 2 points we participate in it. And if the existing knowledge is there, that may not be exactly in the format of EVARS. Dr. Dhiman has his own thresholds and favorable windows identified. So we can roll out some services for the health sector. Definitely. Thank you very much. And Dr. Rupa, an excellent presentation. I'd like to discuss with you separately, maybe at some point. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhan, for your continued support. I request Dr. Akash, sir, to take it forward, actually, for discussions. Dr. Akash, sir. Dr. Akash, may I request you to take the discussions forward, sir?
You have requested.
I'm requesting you, sir, for taking the discussion forward, in fact.
Yes.
And action for that.
Yes. So, thank you to all the speakers for the presentation and the wonderful discussion. I think all the state officers present here would have benefited from the discussion. And if you all would recall in the beginning of the meeting, we made an understanding that at the end of the discussion, we will eventually identify some states who are willing to move forward to take this up as a project in their state and implement that tool for the purpose of early warning identification. WHO recommended at least 4 states should come forward in this year, and maybe 4 more can come up in the next year. We heard from her presentation how countries like Brazil, Mexico, and others have really made, and if those countries using this tool could make a use of these variables to generate alert, we can also do it. We have talented professionals across the country sitting and in different states who can make use of this tool and help in identifying potential threats of vector-borne diseases. Even though as it is as of now of dengue and arboviral diseases, we heard that they also intend to introduce into malaria and other vector-borne diseases of relevance. So it's unfolding itself, and there will be more opportunities. But foremost, it's required that at least some states identify themselves. What I heard from the presentation, it was expected that states Karnataka, Kerala, and Delhi, and I need to hear from them if they are sitting in the audience and to hear from them whether they are in a status to take this forward. Please look that there are 2 important requirements. One is your willingness. Willingness means your availability, your team's availability, your confidence that you can take on board the VBD and ADHD officers and along with the climate team to get this implemented. And second, of course, availability of the data in the district that you choose to implement that. As far as IMD data is concerned, we heard from Dr. Bhan that he is willing to provide all necessary support, and in his understanding, district level data would be available in almost most of the districts in the country. So it's the state officers to come forward, and they are confident that they can tie up with the VVD and IDSP team along with the climate team in their state and take this forward. We will like to enroll them as the first states to go on for this year. So if I think Karnataka or Kerala or Delhi or maybe any other state who is interested, raise their, open up their mics and come forward and let us know.
So Karnataka is ready, sir. Can I come in? Good morning, sir. Yes. I'm Dr. Veena, the nodal officer for NPCC HH from Karnataka, for the vector-borne disease, sir.
I think you heard the conditions, and we are glad that you are willing to take this up.
Yes, sir.
So we put it on board. There will be independent discussions with you by the mentor team out here at the center.
Yes, sir.
Who will further take it on with you about deliberating on the details. We'd like to hear from other states. Any other state, please?
Good afternoon, sir. This is Dr. Manu from Kerala, sir. We are also ready to take it up, sir. So we'll be very much happy to have it, sir.
Okay, so that's good. We are happy to hear from Kerala. Kerala has also given the agreement, and we'll have separate discussions with the mentor team. Delhi, I'm not very sure, is here present today. Any other state who would be interested for this year? Any other state interested in enrolling for this project in this year? Haryana, Chhattisgarh, Odisha. I can see you here, Chandigarh. Others are by name. I am not able to identify the state. Madhya Pradesh. Any other state, please come forward. See, you have to understand that in the climate change program, there is a requirement to undertake surveillance of the important climate sensitive illnesses in along with the climate factors. And one of the foremost that goes after air pollution and heat now is vector-borne diseases. And this is an opportunity and golden opportunity for the state to take it forward as the pioneer state in the project. We heard from Kerala and Karnataka being willing to take it forward in this year. Which other state present today is interested? We'd like to hear.
Dr. Akash, I need to leave for another meeting, if you permit kindly.
Sure.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. I think the reason why others may not be stating is that they are not very sure if their VVD team and IDSP team will get together. Is that the reason? But I can see some of the states here sitting here. What about their understanding? Kashmir, Meghalaya, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Chandigarh. Maybe if they are not willing to come forward right now to this session, maybe we'll give them an opportunity by writing to them and inviting them to which state other than Kerala. What do you say? Go ahead with this year. important activity. IDSPs across the country as well as the VBDs have entomologists who should take up this exercise, and I will request that the climate
We are interested, sir.
This is which state?
Meghalaya, sir.
Meghalaya. Okay. Will you be in a position to take your VBD officers, IDSP officer, and climate officer together for this particular commitment? Meghalaya, you think that
we
have the possibility to take all the three officers together this year? I think we've lost the communication, so of course we'll try to see if Meghalaya can be connected and take that as the fourth state for today, after today's discussion. And then of course we'll invite others, and we'll also need a bit of an evaluation. The mental team will also have to do a bit of an exercise with them to see whether they really qualifying for being eligible this year. So that will also be our requirement in the next meeting with the members of the concerned states that test their bidding test. I think that's what I had to say as to go forward. And I now request Dr. Ashan Sharma, is there anything else we can discuss today?
I want to.
No, sir, actually, you have covered everything. But the states, actually, as you rightly said, they need to actually do some homework in terms of the data available with them. Commitment is one way of doing it in our meeting, but let them go back and see the data, whether it's available or not. We will be requiring two types of data, retrospective data for 3 to 5 years, and now present data and the frequency of the data flow also. So before we call mentors, before we take decision, we need to look into that, sir. In the next meeting, they need to forward all the available information to us so that we look into the data and accordingly take decision with the core group, which even Dr. Rukumari or some officers you can select. So we look into it and then we move forward actually with the training part of it, which is actually the other steps in the near future, sir.
Yeah, so I think that's an important thing. Yes, you have to consider your eligibility not only in context of your willingness, but also in context of availability of data for your being able to deliver on the project. But definitely we'll be writing to you all formally so that you can take the other officers of the VBD and IDSP department on board using that formal communication, and then thereafter come back with us suggesting that you have looked into your available database and you are in a position to participate. The letter will let you know what sort of a data you need to share with us in advance for the mentor team to be able to evaluate your eligibility for participation. So I think that you will be very soon receiving a letter from this end. And is that enough? Should we close for the day? Should
last comment, sir. Actually, it's not only that four state. Let me request all these states, don't forget that you are also to be participate in phase manners. Kindly try to strengthen your data, put your data in place. So it's not that we are having only four states. It will be for all states. In near future, it is going to helpful. So I request all the state nodal officers, BBD officers, and even IDSB officers, kindly validate your data, make actually your data authentic, flow should be smooth. Now it should be available actually. And 3 to 5 year data should be available with each state district wise. That is my request to you. It is already there. You have to organize yourself. That is my request, sir. Thank you.
Yes, I agree with it. Also for all states to ensure that their data base is strengthened, they have the required data. Maybe on evaluation, we may find only few states suitable to have adequate strength of the database to be undertaking the project. But eventually, all states will have to undertake this project because it's an important component of the climate change program that you should have a surveillance system with an EORS in the VBD, including climatic factor. That's an important part of the climatic program. So if you are for some reasons not prepared in these months, then you have to ensure that you are working throughout the year to be ready early next year to go on the next year for this this evaluation and this project undertaking. So please, I think that's it. We'll be writing to you. Anything else, or we should just go for the vote of thanks.
Dr. Srivastava.
Yes, sir.
I want to say 2 points.
Yes.
In the initial exercise, please persuade Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand or Chandigarh. There must be one state for the preliminary exercise as representative of Himalayan region.
Okay.
It is so, very crucial.
Yes. So I once again, I think we have Kashmir sitting here and we have Meghalaya sitting here, but there will be other states that you have suggested, like Uttarakhand and which else?
Himachal Pradesh or Chandigarh?
Yes, I saw Himachal Pradesh today morning in the
party. They have written that please give some time.
Yes. So okay. So in that case, you have been given time. We are writing to you all, and you will come back. Yes, I heard from Himachal Pradesh. Okay. So I'm suggesting that all of you look into your databases, and we'll be writing to you and come back once you are ready with that. And we will be interested in Himalayan states being also represented, because they are the states who are going to have the first impact of climate change in context of VBD. So that's an important point by Dr. Dhiman, and I accept that.
Dr. Sir, another point is about vector mapping. Say, for dengue vectors, we have mapped the available information and we have submitted a paper that we will share after some time. But generating data at district level with the available infrastructure of entomologists, I think will be very difficult. We can generate such data at sentinel sites, the sites which you identify for early warning system. But I don't think, Dr. S. N. Sharma, do we have the infrastructure of entomologists?
No, that's what actually Dr. Srivastava is actually talking about. The available, the personnel would be undertaking those surveillance actually. In case we want the entomological indicators to be part of the EWARS, Dr. Rupari mentioned very clearly, These can be added actually, the entomological indices, if you are having a regular entomological monitoring in those parts, districts, sub-districts, that can be part of the EWARS. Otherwise, we will leave this indicator, we will include the epidemiological indicators only.
Yeah. So, it will be better for selected sites.
Right. So, I also agree, you will need an entomologist maybe, and the states which have states that have entomologists, for them it will be a better goal for us. And for those who do not have entomologists, I think first they should always try to find one. If they can't find, then as Dr. Dhiman is suggesting, they should try to find some sentinel sites where some initiatives can be taken. So that state by state case, I can't comment generally for everyone, but the states have to take a call. And if you have questions, you have Dr. Roop Kumar, Dr. S.N. Sharma, Dr. Dhiman always available. Just an email away. You can just write to them and clarify your doubts. Kashmir Division is suggesting that they don't face VBDs. So I don't know if you want them on board for the given year. I don't know.
Sir, one important part actually I would like to highlight, sir, municipal corporations, we are leaving actually urban township. So I request all the state officers who are representing here should also give us one town, metro cities, mega cities, where actually we can put EWAC actually system in place separately, sir. Besides these four states, I would request one municipal corporation who is maintaining this data very perfectly should come forward, and we will also include them. We should include that town also, sir.
Yeah. Yes, so what we have been suggested here is that what is being suggested is that in your given state, if you do not have data available for an entire region, but you do have available data for a particular district or for certain towns looked after municipal corporations, with a richer set of database, then even that will be good enough to take a go for your state. So you need not be discouraged if you do not have a very glorious database for all of your state. Just look on deeply into where is a good rich database available, and it's very likely that municipal corporations of cities will definitely have a richer database. That is, as vector maintenance is one of their jobs. So states like Delhi, Rajasthan and Gujarat, which have big corporations like Jaipur, Ahmedabad, can also explore these corporations for availability of database and get back to us when we'll be writing to you about what are your interests and what databases do you have. So I think inputs have been received from all the panelists, and I think you people have understood what we are saying. You will have opportunities to write to us. We are available across an email for your queries. You will be receiving letter from us, and then once we receive an input from you, then the mentor team will work with the concerned stage how to implement this EVARS. So I think Dr. Roop Kumar, there was something you also had to say about,
yes,
there is a planned workshop in future. You can also please let us know about that.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Akash Srivastava. It's a very good plan that Dr. Sarma and Dr. Akash Srivastava, they have mentioned about the selection of the states, and further the selection of the cities is very important, and also in some districts. In one state, if there are not a systematic collection of the retrospective data in all the districts, they can select some districts. So it depends upon the states. And in the first phase, but my suggestion is first phase, you please make a core group. You have already a core group at the headquarter, and they will monitor state. And the state, what were like the Karnataka, Kerala, and Meghalaya, they are, and Odisha, I've mentioned, they want to be part of the EWAR system. They have to constitute a core group in their state also to follow up this EWAR system. Like in this core group, my suggestion is they should include one IT person also. Even the IDSP, who is managing the IDSP or IGP, or some IT person will be there with epidemiologist or surveillance officer, that will be better. And the state should have also a core group to monitor, and because they have to select further in the district and all the state. So there will be change, so that it will be easy for us. And whenever you will make a core group, and that you just create a email group of that, just you constitute an email group, so that we will link this email group with our experts also, and whenever they will get some problems, implementation problem, and it will be clarified. Like in inter is the inter-country border meeting in Bhutan and Assam. Last 2 years back, we have conducted, and we constituted a core group, and where we share through our WhatsApp. So this type of the system should have, so that any problem facing by the state, we can solve it immediately. And the second step, definitely, the demo training is required. And who is the members in the state and the district and the even in the national headquarters also there will be core group who can manage the dashboard one, and there should be a demo training. Definitely we will support that training. And now the COVID situation, during this COVID situation, we cannot organize physical training. We will organize virtual training. When the situation will improve, definitely we can support for the physical training also. And if necessary, we can invite experts also from WHO-TDR here, if it is required. So thank you very much. And about the vector mapping, you are discussing this risk mapping is only depends upon the epidemiological data, what Dr. Sharma has mentioned about the risk mapping. If you want to do risk mapping of the vector is also a very important, you know, factors of that. In addition, that will be very good information for the program. We should have the vector monitoring. We should have the entomologists, and we don't have the knowledge of the vectors in all the district and the peripheral level. Definitely, there are publications there, and this project to the independent. This project can be taken. I will suggest to Dr. Singh, they can take one project as a research project to the CME, where they can collect all these literature review, collect all this information, what is the status of vectors and resistance status, and they can develop papers also. And wherever the data is not available, in those areas, there is no information about the vectors and susceptibility status, they can send central team there. Like the NCDC team, when I was there at NCDC, we usually go to visit. So they can go like the 1 week or 2 weeks, they can stay in those areas and they can generate data. And likely they can prepare the mapping. That will be very useful information for the program. So that type of work that can be done. Thank you very much, Dr. Akash, once again, and Dr. Sharma for taking this initiative, and it's very good efforts. Thank you.
Sharma ji, I'm Dr. Bhaskar.
Yes.
I am Dr. Bhaskar, consultant entomologist working under Dr. Simi Diwari. So in the division of zoonotic diseases program, so I have been assigned to probe some parameters to actually incorporate for the control and prevention of vector-borne zoonotic diseases. So actually, I am very fortunate to discuss about this information regarding the dengue transmission, particularly the soon after monsoon we have and cases in the place, dengue cases in a place. So the inherent properties of Aedes aegypti, particularly transovarian transmission, and the second one is the eggs withstand desiccation even a year apart. Suppose in a place, actually there are two things are related to dengue transmission. One is the rain dependent things and rain independent things. So rain dependent and independent, rain dependent things are more vulnerable for the dengue transmission. For example, the mosquitoes which has infected may actually lay eggs in things, rain dependent things like automobile tires. So it actually dried up. So there's same, and eggs might have a role to transmit soon after monsoon. So actually the flow of viruses from eggs to adult. So actually suppose we collected eggs from vulnerable places, suppose the eggs are housing with virus. So the flow of virus from eggs to adult. So and after the emergence, and rather than the dengue cases transmission from person to person, so directly we can expect the infected mosquitoes, those have emerged from the eggs which was actually housing the particular virus. So this particular and information might be established because you are actually experts and gathered here. So this type of information might be actually led to the index cases prior to human. Actually, the index cases prior to human
throw some information about that. So the axis from the infected X to the emergence of the and mosquito is lacking. I think this is the forum, right forum, to discuss about that. So this type of proposal and might be actually give some information or throw lights the places soon after monsoon we are getting cases. So this is my humble implication on the transmission of the dengue. Thank you.
Sir, I want to add on this, Dr. P. Bhaskar. The genome monitoring of the mosquitoes, pools for dengue virus presence or other virus presence would be the answer to the question which is raised about the transovirial transmission kind of thing. The genome monitoring, if it is done in some places means North India, South India and representative places where we can send the mosquito to check the virus in them. So these can be answer to the question for input in the EVOR system so that we have knowledge that which kind of virus is in the circulation with the vector population.
Oh, thank you sir. So I actually
Dr. Srivastava ji.
Yes. So
I want to add something.
Yes sir, please.
Regarding transovarial transmission, we have to generate data to find out its significance, because last year there was no outbreak of dengue, even the cases were also very very low. So yes, had there been any transovarial transmission, so every year there should have been cases, but very low transmission. Mm-hmm. As regards independent of rain, dengue outbreaks without rains, we have generated data from Coimbatore and we have seen when the rains are deficient, outbreaks occur. That is basically because of water storage practices. There is no rains, even water supply is not there. People are resorted to store more and more water and it leads to outbreak. So that is the example, Dr. Bhaskar's question. Thank you.
I would like to add here that CDC has a virus lab there in CMB division, and I was there at NCDC. We monitoring the virus load in mosquito vector, mosquito, even the calculate the minimum infection rate throughout the daily on the basis of this result of the virus detection lab, like VAD lab there at NCDC, and we could predict the outbreak in 2010 also. And that was also, we also mapping of all over the daily about the prevalence of the virus there in Addis Ababa as well as the Addis Ababa. So they, I don't know what the functional status of this lab presently, but it is very good lab. So it generates very good information for data for prediction of the outbreak.
And that is why I also interrupted.
Dr. Bhaskar, let me tell you, this is a good discussion and we have been doing it as Dr. Rukmari said. But under the EVOR system, how we can fit, we will discuss that. Because it's exactly, we do not know how much transovarian actually transmission is going on presently. So let's not actually divert to the discussions. EVOR system in totality, the data which is available in the district will be difficult, what we are talking. So Dr. Akash, we are to be actually on the subject. That is my
request. We have actually established, I am told that actually there is mosquitoes, antigen analysis is going on in all the places, particularly in Tamil Nadu.
Yes, sir, yes.
It may be still good, actually. So, yeah.
I think for the objective of today's meeting has been met, and it's time that we wind up the meeting. I request Dr. Ashan Sharma to look into how at earliest a communication can be sent to all the states about what we are requesting about their participation. And with this, I request Dr. Shiva Prasad to give a vote of thanks, please.
Good afternoon to all. Thank you for the opportunity to propose the vote of thanks. And I would like to thanks to our director NCDC, Dr. Sujit K. Singh, regarding the giving the opportunity to conduct this meeting before the actual meeting on the EWARS on July 31st. We are going to conduct that meeting, actual meeting. And I would like to thanks to Dr. Simi Tiwari from the Center of Medical Entomology and Vector Control Management, Joint Director, for the giving the remarks. And I would like to thanks to Dr. R. C. Dheeman, advisor, former scientist G, NIMR, and Dr. Himmat Singh, NIMR, giving the brief introduction of the VVDs and EWARS. And I would like to thank to Dr. S. N. Sarma, former joint director and present consultant in Center of Medical Entomology and Vector Control, for giving the introduction on the EWARS. And then Dr. Roop Kumari, technical officer, malaria, WHO country, I would like to thank to her also for giving a nice presentation on EWARS. And then I'll thank to all the participants who have participated in this meeting, and thank you to all. Before that, we want to, Dr. Akshay Kumar sir want to give some announce to all the state program officer before the winding of the program.
Thank you, Dr. Siva Prasad. And I am Dr. Akshay, Assistant Director at NCDC. I would like to announce important notice that tomorrow is a webinar on health sector action plan for preparedness and response to heat wave. So I will request all the state nodal officer from heat one states to kindly join, and ask the district nodal officer on climate change to join from 2 to 4 p.m. So tomorrow 2 to 4 p.m. kindly be there. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
Dr. Roop Kumari, Dr. S. N. Sharma.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Sharma, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Roop. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Dheeman. Thank you.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.